सो मुझे वो दिन आज जो है, ही हैज सरपास्ड, आई एम अ पीडियाट्रिक सर्जन, सो वट एवर आई डू ही हैज टेकन इट वन स्टेप फर्दर by specializing in surgery on pediatric hearts. And this is just great. In addition to which, he is also involved in education. So Dr. Munir jo hai, in Aga Khan University, when I was their first associate dean for postgraduate medical education, and Dr. Munir was also that. And so he is, I see him more than just a technician. And therefore, to see somebody who I knew as a first year resident in surgery to where he is now, there's nothing that makes me happier. So Dr. Munir, this is really a pleasure to invite you and to invite Dr. Babar and of course to invite Dr. Shazia and Dr. Nadeem. So back to you, Dr. Amir.
Dr. Bozan has taken the entire wind out of the sail. All I am now left with is MBBS and MD and stuff like that to and I'll do try my best to read through. The first speaker today would be Dr. Munir Amanullah. He is currently professor and consultant pediatric and congenital cardiothoracic surgeon in the department of cardiothoracic surgery at Liaquat National Hospital. He did his MBBS from Dow Medical College in 1999, and then he joined the residency program at Aga Khan University, where he and I were partners in crime. He graduated in 1996 and was given the best graduate residency graduate award. I presented it to him. He deserved it. He went on to the UK to do FRCS in from Edinburgh University, from the Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh and also Glasgow in 1997. Then did a fellowship in cardiothoracic surgery in 2003, training at Freeman Hospital in UK. Then did another FRCS, this time in cardiothoracic surgery in 2003. Then he did a fellowship in pediatric and congenital cardiothoracic surgery in 2006. And then they ran out of fellowships in UK. So he said he should come back. And his arrival in Pakistan, I remember, there was a conference that we were doing at CBEC, at SIUT some years ago. And one of the registrants was Muhammad Amanullah from Manchester. I didn't realize who it was. And in the audience, I could see him sitting there. I said, what are you doing here? He said, I'm a registered participant. I said, what are you doing? He said, I want to come back to Pakistan to serve and to do cardiothoracy. I thought he was crazy, but clearly he was not. He was determined. And I must add a little bit of an anecdote over here. His entire family of the four components, himself, his wife, and his son and daughter-in-law, three are in UK. He is the one over here still working. And there's a lot of pull to go back to UK, but his determination to work and serve over here is exemplary. So hats off. Of course, much of this is because he is my friend. So he's also been an associate dean of the postgraduate medical education.
And I think that's another reason why you're also here rather than in the States.
So welcome, Munir. Our second speaker today would be Dr. Babar Hassan, who's associate professor and consultant pediatric cardiologist in the Department of Pediatric and Child Health at the Aga Khan University. And he graduated from the Aga Khan University Medical School in 1999 and did a pediatric residency in 2006, graduating from the IUPUI Indianapolis, US program over there. Then he went on to do his pediatric cardiology and advanced imaging and intervention at the Harvard Medical School. He has a diverse interests in research, and while he's obviously interested in clinical work, he's also interested in research in quality improvement sciences, in artificial intelligence and its use in medical care, and also health equity. And we'll be unpacking the aspects of health equity today in his talk. He has more than 80 papers to his credit and $4 million worth of research grants under his name. So welcome, Dr. Babar. So these are the two speakers. Then we have two eminent panelists who are also pediatric cardiologists. So Dr. Nadeem Aslam is an interventional pediatric cardiologist, an alumnus of Dow Medical College. He completed his postgraduate training at the Aga Khan University and obtained his fellowship in pediatrics and pediatric cardiology from CPSP in Pakistan. He has clinical expertise in research and interest in aspects of general pediatric cardiology, but also interventional and minimally invasive therapies, and has also served as head in, of the fellowship program, director for the pediatric cardiology program at the Aga Khan University. And lastly, Dr. Shazia Mohsin. She is an assistant professor and section head and director of pediatric echo lab in the Department of Pediatrics and Child Health at the Aga Khan University. She has 10 years of experience in pediatric cardiology and has also worked abroad in Riyadh, but came back again to serve people in her own country. She happens to be one of the very few women in pediatric cardiologists with an expertise in fetal echocardiography in this country. She's also very interestingly a member of the Gender Disparity, Equity and Quality Working Group of the American College of Cardiology. And she represents only membership from low middle income countries. So that is a great privilege for Pakistan as well. Her goal is to develop a pediatric echocardiography and training program for pediatric intensivists, neonatologists, and pediatricians to maximize the diagnostic impact in the area and with minimal resources for early recognition and prompt referral. And that is what one of our driving forces is. So welcome to the panelists. So the format would be that we'll have these two talks, first Dr. Munir and then Dr. Babar. After that, we will open the discussion for both speakers as well as the panelists. The questions will come after the second talk. My suggestion is that please note down any questions that you come that come in your mind so that you can post them at later on. For the people online, we've got a significant number of people from Pakistan and abroad online also. And you can also put your questions in the chat box, which Mr. Fareed over here will be compiling, and we'll be putting them again to the panelists at the end of the second talk. So without further ado, Dr. Munir Madhavan.
Assalamu alaikum everyone and good afternoon, and thank you very much Amir and Dr. Mazum for the kind words, and even though I don't deserve it, I'll take it. The title is a bit worrying, that mission and double vision and despair and whatever, but we'll see what we can do about that. So our vision has been quite diplopic. That is that every child born anywhere in Pakistan with a congenital heart disease should have access to appropriate medical and surgical care, which is probably not possible, and to develop an environment conducive for training, education, and research, and produce future leaders in pediatric cardiac services, which is possible. The only constant is change, but maybe not. If you can recognize, that's Amir Jafri and myself about 30 years ago. So like Dr. Mazum said, that we are basically here to treat hearts, and it's not just kids that we treat. We treat the parents, and we treat the family, and we treat the nation. Now this is a 12-year-old girl by the name of Amar Ravanti. There were floods in Pakistan, as you all know, in 2009, in the interior of Sindh. One of our colleagues went to that flood to serve the people. And this mother brought this girl, carrying her, who's 12 years old, in her arms and saying that, "You're a doctor, do something, she's going to die." She was blue, with a saturation in her 60s, we are, our saturation are more than 95. So you can imagine. And that doctor did not know what to do with her because she was not a cardiologist nor a cardiac surgeon, but she was a surgeon. And she promptly said, okay, let's take her to Karachi, and got her to AKU. But there was despair because people had told them that nothing could be done and this girl is going to die. Let's go back a few decades. The beauty of cardiac surgery has been delusional. And we had the first delusion of these three people: Alfred Blalock, Helen Tosic, and Vivian Thomas. They had the audacity to think that they could manage and treat blue babies. Babies were born with low oxygen. It all started actually in 1939 when Robert Gross did the first PDA ligation at the Boston Children, and then he was promptly kicked out. Helen contacted him and said that, why can't we create a PDA and treat these patients who are blue? And he said, that's a rubbish idea. So she discussed it with her friend, Alfred Blalock, who were both there at Baltimore, and John Hopkins. And he was actually working on a dog model producing pulmonary hypertension. And his lab technician was Vivian Thomas, a black man. And in those time, black American, African, we can't call them the N-word anymore. So those guys, he was the person who was doing the actual technical stuff. And with his help, they managed to do the first shunt by connecting the subclavian artery to the pulmonary artery. And that created the first operation to improve the cyanotic babies. It was a delusion whether you can do it or not. And they did. We are riding on their shoulders. So we managed to take Amarvanti into AKU, fully supported. They didn't have to pay any money. We closed her VSD, we fixed her pulmonary valve, recreated the anterior and posterior cuff, and recreated the pulmonary artery. And then this is her on day one post-op. This is her 1 year post-op. And yesterday I got the good news that she visited Nadeem and she's pregnant. We have delivered, and she will deliver. But what about this girl? 5 month old, weighs 3 kilograms. She's skin and bones. And you can see that she has got what is known as cardiac cachexia. She's got a VSD and she's a heart failure. Does this infant really have a chance? Well, again, delusion. This is, does anybody know who this is? Walton Lillehei. Now he had the craziest idea. He created the only operation in the world with 200% mortality. Now, can you imagine 200% mortality? You can ask, how is that possible? He thought, if I can open the heart of the patient and support that heart and lung through connections to the parent, which will have the same blood group, then I can stop the heart and I can operate on that heart. And he created the concept of cross-circulation using the parent as the heart-lung machine. He did 68 operations, some VSDs, majority of them were tetralogy of Fellows, 28 of them died, 40 survived. The 40 would have all died. So think at it that way. This is 1950. This is not 1999, this is 1950s. And you can see the amount of people trying to be involved in that first cross-circulation operation. And now we can deliver them. And this is the baby, first day post-op, enjoying a bottle of whatever he has. And you can imagine a few years ago, a 2-week-old unit from Balochistan comes to AKU, first born after 4 years, cyanosed, 65% saturation. He does an adult echo. Adult cardiologist does an echo. And he's got transposition of great arteries. There's no one going to take care of him. There's no expertise. He's going to die. But can something be done? This is an area of despair. But again, you have a person by the name of John Gibbon. He was a medical student, fourth year medical student, like the two sitting over there. He was looking after a patient who had pulmonary embolism after cholecystectomy. And she was dying. And he was wondering, how can I make a machine which can bypass the lungs and the heart so that I can fix this? After completing his medical college from Harvard, he got signed up by IBM for this idea. He worked in the IBM laboratory for the next 4 or 5 years. And then he was enlisted in the World War II. And he came back and he worked on it again. And he got an assistant by the name of Mary Hopkins, whose job was to go out into the city, catch all the cats, bring them, and then have the prototype heart-lung machine run on them. The cats all died, but he married that Mary Hopkins. But it was in 1954 that he did manage to come up with the first prototype of the heart-lung machine. It took a week to assemble and a week to disassemble. So you could only do one operation in a month. And he did the first open heart, the actual open heart surgery on an 8-year-old girl with ASD, and she survived. He did three more, and they all died. And he never operated after that. But he gave his creation to the world. And today, on that creation, we stand. And we just don't stand. We have gone a little further. This is a TGA baby, again from Balochistan, brought to AKU. We operated, we arrested, we put him on ECMO, extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, open chest and being managed and by a heart-lung machine, not through the chest, but through the neck. That's the team who were involved initially, and you can see a few familiar faces and another few familiar faces. And the man who made it all possible for us was one of us, a Pakistani surgeon trained and residing in UK, who would come and help us out with difficult cases, Mr. Asif Hassan, and he made us do the ECMO. This was the first successful ECMO ever performed in Pakistan. This was 2012. Let's look at what we are challenged with. Even though this is an old saying, but it still rings true. The time has come when physicians have to decide whether they will continue to be part of the problem or whether they are going to be part of the solution. We as a team would like to think that we are part of the solution. 85% cannot afford any type of surgery. It's poorly existent. We are at least 20%, 20 years behind developed countries and even 10 years behind our immediate neighbors. 4.5 billion people have no access to cardiac surgery in the world. Many die before having any chance to present for surgery, let alone be attempted for surgery. Many countries with population of up to 50 million have no access to cardiac surgery. 90% of the 10 million children that are born each year will die because of suboptimal care. And it still holds true. The numbers may have improved slightly. But we know that the improvement over time comes when the numbers increase, the volumes increase, and your mortality and morbidity decreases. And also when you, they found that when you separated the adult from the pediatrics, the results improved. And Florence Nightingale was probably the bane of our problems, because we had to perform the mortality and morbidity meeting. And because she said that perhaps the most important of all elements are the complications occurring after operations. And that is so true. And Mr. Hassan then wrote a paper in 2000 in which he said, how can we minimize the learning curve? And one of his points was, and which is quite true, either invite the established surgeon to assist them, the unit, in surgery. So instead of inviting them, we have taken this ethos of going to them and helping them out. This was the pediatric cardiac service team in AKU. And the first mission to Kabul was held in 2008. It was an opportunity to develop a unit in a war-torn country, but we had the delusion of being saviors, delusion that we will be welcomed with open arms, delusion that everyone would be willing to learn from this great team of ours. And soon we were in despair when we realized that they don't love us, at the resistance to change, and the fact that Pakistan was not their friendly country. But we shouldered on. We helped their surgeons do operations. We treated their kids the same way as we treat ours. I don't find any difference in them. They're same kids. We did 4 missions, and we provided cardiac services for cardiac surgery, echo, outpatients, and education and training. We developed a human and institutional collaboration, and the last mission saw acceptance. We learned from this. This was our team taking a day off after hard work. We've also done medical camps in Maldives and other countries. And we have done free medical camps in Pakistan, in Banu Aqil and Quetta and Umarkot. And these are just some pictures just to confirm, yes, that we have gone there. Then came mission Najaf. And we said that no, we need to be invited and we should not be imposed. We had that information from our last missions. We should have a preliminary meeting to develop outlines of the mission. We are not going to be the heroes. We develop team-to-team contract prior to mission. So everybody knew each other. The surgeons, the cardiologists knew the cardiologist, the intensivists knew the intensive care, the nurses knew the nurses. So everybody was there to know each other before we actually went to do an operation or to do the mission. We developed an understanding and trust between both the groups. We developed human capacity towards independence. That is the target. We provided service to the people, to the children and the people of Iraq. And we trained and we educated. It is holy, whether you like it or not. Hazrat Ali is buried in Najaf, and Hazrat Imam Hussein is buried in Kalbala, which is only about 80 kilometers away. And it takes about an hour and a half to go there. This was at mission teams at different times. That's Dr. Amen. She's holding a Glenn baby who came to us with saturation of 50%. And we operated, and she's ready to go home now. There's Dr. Babar doing what he does best, looking after his patients. And he's looking at the wound to check if I've closed the wound correctly or not. And there's Dr. Kalbi Abbas, who is with the miracle baby. This baby was the tiniest baby they had operated there ever. I mean, we had operated with them. And it was a VSD, and he was 5 kilograms. And on a Friday morning, he just had to die. So we tried to save him. And as it turned out that God was kind to all of us, and we were able to save him. And he's going home today. We'd had capacity building at all levels. There's Kalbi Abbas teaching the ICU nurses, that is me talking to the anesthetists as to how we should run the anesthesia. I'm training the surgeons hands-on on the patient. There's nursing staff getting trained. We're talking about how to build capacity. And I think we have delivered. What do you say, Babu? Okay, thank you. So that's goodbye to Najaf for the time being, but we'll be there again. And this is something we got just recently, a message from an Iraqi brother. Assalamu alaikum, a small hero extends his salam to Pakistan. So what did Mission Najaf teach us? Deliverance was there. Yes, from non-acceptance to appreciation. The first mission, there was no acceptance. From aloofness to integration, they came to know that we were doing it free. They thought we were charging money to the country. When they came to know that we were doing it free out of the goodness, I won't want to go out of the goodness of our heart, but we were doing it free. From dependence to independence. Now they started doing those operations that I have been able to teach to them. It was not that they did not know it. They did not have the confidence that they would be able to do it. And both teams are now looking forward to the fourth mission sometime in October, November this year. So in conclusion, congenital heart disease is a challenge for Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Iraq, and any other country which is a lower middle income. But with proper planning and implementation of phased programs, we can achieve a lot. Results will always need to be improved and continue the collaboration to improve outcomes. Before I end, we were both residents of Dr. Farhat Mazum in the 1990s. She must have been despair to have a resident like me. And Amir was always delusional. But Dr. Mazum delivered. Thank you very much.
It's a difficult talk to follow. This is always what Munir does to me, is that he does such a phenomenal job that I just have to then scramble to keep up with that. So first of all, thank you very much to Dr. Farhat Mazum, to Amir Jaffer, and to the CBEC team for inviting us and giving us this chance to speak. I see Dr. Adib Zvi in the crowd also, and thank you very much, sir, for being here. It gives us a lot of encouragement. So what I'm going to be talking about, and definitely it's going to be kind of not the fat lady singing and stuff. It's going to be something, it's kind of an anti-climax to what he's built, Munir has built, but that's, inshallah, I'll try to keep up with. Okay, yeah. So a scope of congenital heart disease in a low resource setting and equity versus equality. And what I'm going to talk about over the next 20 minutes is that is how are these definitions different? And if one goes into these definitions with a very closed mindset and how the Weber dictionary or the English dictionary or the Oxford dictionary writes it, we will set ourselves for failure. And not only failure in how we'll be delivering, but also failure in a significant amount of discouragement that the team will go through if we don't have a flexible mind in defining these terms. I don't have any financial disclosures and no financial association. So, you know, this is a slide that people will kind of show to give the difference. And I'm not going to dwell into a lot of this because Dr. Mazum told me that you've had a lot of discussion around this. But, you know, equality is that if you treat everybody kind of equal, and the assumption is that everybody are starting off at the same level. And naturally, if you look at the first picture, you know, that small child is definitely not starting off at the same level. And so you may not be able to achieve what you want to achieve if one was to treat everybody equal. You know, equity is again different in the sense that, you know, it gives the maximum amount of support to the person who needs the most amount of support so that everybody reaches a certain amount of equal. But what is interesting is the third picture. And is that if we systematically study the disparity that leads to a lack of equity, and we systematically try to remove that disparity, we may be actually bringing everybody on the same level without giving that even that disparity in the resources that we are allocating. So some of the work that we do is to really systematically define our continuum of care. And the area that I'm interested in, and now Dr. Shazi and Dr. Nadeem are interested in also, is to create a way of measuring how systematically disparities are introduced, consciously or unconsciously, so that we can work towards removing some of them. We may not be able to remove all of them, but at least some of them, and at least come to that third picture that we have. So one would say, and I used to do this when I was in the US and planning to come back to Pakistan, and mazedar baat ye hai ki Pakistan mein, and I'm going to go into Urdu if that's perfect. So because and you had said that tone, and I was so glad to do that. So Pakistan, though 10 saal mein US mein tha apne J1 visa ki wajah se, and had never come back to Pakistan. Every dinner and lunch that you go to, everybody will come there in their Rolls Royce and BMWs and Mercs and everything, and everybody will talk about Pakistan. Ke Pakistan ko yun fix karna, yun fix karna, yun fix karna. And then when I said, "Kya main ja raha hu wapas," and they said, "Ki apne dimag ka MRI karwao. You are crazy. Why are you going back? You're coming out of Harvard. You're gonna have a fantastic career. Why are you doing this?" And I said, "Yeah, abhi to aap baith ke baat kar rahe the, fix karna hai. Ab ja ke fix karna hai na, because Aldo Castaneda." That Munir showed, who's actually considered the father of infant cardiac surgery. He's from Guatemala, and he was at Boston Children's. And when he found out that I'm interested in going back, he told me one thing: Barbers, don't do medical missions. You want to make a difference back home, you have to go there and make sure you burn your bridges. Because tum aaj aake jab baithoge na, aur apne problems ko dekhoge aur solve karoge, tumhare dimag mein ye nahi hoga ki mere paas green card hai, main bhag jaunga yahan se. You will do it. So I think that was something that I learned. So when I was going back, people saying, "Yeah, Pakistan to diarrhea pneumonia ka mulk hai. Wahan tum apne skills ko jaake kharabi karoge. Wahan ja kyun rahe?" And you know what is interesting is that 50% of kids who are born with congenital heart disease across the globe comes from only 4 countries: Pakistan, India, China, and Indonesia. Why? Because of the birth rate. The higher the birth rate, the more the congenital anomalies. The most common congenital anomaly that a child is born with is a congenital heart disease. The most common, and people will not know this. And I'll show you a very interesting slide that shows that if you have a surgical specialty developed karni hai for congenital anomalies, where would you make the most amount of difference? And it comes from the Global Initiative of Child Surgery. Ke slide mein aapko dikhaunga. And it would be surprising which that subspecialty will be. Anyhow, this is a slide that I kind of show of the disparity and the inequity that we see in healthcare. As Munir pointed out, 90% of congenital heart disease lies in countries that do not have congenital heart disease care to that level that US mein aapko ya UK mein milega. UK mein ye bachcha ek transposition ka, who was prenatally diagnosed, was born a very big chunky baby, was picked up immediately, was operated within the first 6 days of life, and then goes back to that family. But even in the US, there are many families that are not like this. And in fact, as we are writing some of this work up, what is interesting to see is that wahan ke andar jo unke societal inequities hain, wahan pe how can we really empathize with them, and they can empathize with us. And that's the common ground that we can see. Compared this same kid, transposition ka wo bacha hai, Pakistan se hamare paas aaya hai, who has now come to us 8 months of age, 8 month ka wo bacha hai, sahi hai, malnourished hai, infected hai, and already late. A surgery that should have been done at 4 weeks of age now is coming at 6 months of age, and a completely different physiology, and has to go back to that household. Now you deal with this. So you deal with a completely different mindset. So main jab US se wapas aaya tha na, main bada apne high horse pe tha, maine sab kuch karna hai. तो डॉक्टर नदीम असलम ने मुझे बैठा के एक दिन बिठाया था कि सर आप तरह बैठे, थोड़ा सब समझाता हूँ कि ग्राउंड रियलिटी क्या है यहाँ पे. और फिर ग्राउंड रियलिटी आपको समझ में आनी शुरू हो जाती है ये क्या है. एंड द ग्राउंड रियलिटी इज नॉट जस्ट रिसोर्सेज, इट आल्सो फिजियोलॉजी, इट इज आल्सो द पेशेंट कोमॉर्बिडिटीज, इट इज अ कंप्लीटली डिफरेंट पेशेंट. दो द एनाटॉमिकल डिजीज इज वेरी इट्स द सेम, बट एवरीथिंग एल्स अराउंड इट इज कंप्लीटली डिफरेंट. एंड द होल सोशल डिटरमिनेंट्स ऑफ हेल्थ स्टार्ट्स प्लेइंग इनटू द गेम. हमसे एक बात और भी पूछी जाती है कि यार आपका स्पेक्ट्रम क्या है कंजेनिटल हार्ट डिजीज का. तो हम कहते हैं 10 वीक्स ऑफ फीटल लाइफ से शुरू होता है, जहां पे डॉक्टर शाजिया फीटल एको कर रही होती है,
और अंदर कई चीजें भी ट्रीट कर देती हैं पेशेंट्स के. एंड माय ओल्डेस्ट पेशेंट दैट आई हैव इज एन 85 ईयर ओल्ड. द ओल्डेस्ट टॉफ इन पाकिस्तान दैट वाज ऑपरेटेड बाय डॉक्टर मुनीर वाज अ 62 ईयर ओल्ड टॉफ इन NYHA-4 कैटेगरी व्हीलचेयर पे आया था और उसको डॉक्टर मुनीर ने ऑपरेट किया था और एक महीने बाद वो नेशनल स्टेडियम से चलते हुए आया था कि मैं आज मुझे रिक्शा नहीं मिला चलते हुए आया हूँ मैं आपके पास. सो यू कैन मेक अ डिफरेंस. सही है. 62 ईयर ओल्ड. दिस इज अ गाय 32 ईयर ओल्ड विथ कंजेनिटल हार्ट डिजीज अनऑपरेटेड अनरिपेयर्ड जो कि अपने दुकान पे बैठ के अपने भाई को मेड स्कूल के थ्रू गुजारा था इसने. एंड दिस गाय actually went to India to get operated because bahut hi complicated heart disease thi, iski dextrocardia, everything was like flippy floppy, and he got operated, came back, did fine for a year and then died. And uske death ke baad uski puri family jo hai wo ek complete topsy turvy mein gayi hai. Kyun? Kyunki he was the sole breadwinner of the family. Unrepaired heart disease, sole breadwinner of the family, putting his brother through ke nahi tumne padhna hai, main dukan chalaunga. Sahi hai. Ye teeno behne had congenital heart disease. So hamara consanguinity family ka bhi bahut zyada. That girl up there is also somebody that Dr. Munir operated and has also gotten married and about to get pregnant is what she's telling me. So dekhte hain ki kya scene hai. But you know, so they can actually lead a very normal life. But adult congenital heart disease is a very huge burden in our society. So those who don't die in the first 1 year of life, okay, one third of our congenital heart disease hota hai, the rest of the two thirds will live, and they will live as adult congenital heart disease who are now sole breadwinners of their family. So when they die, the whole poverty trap, so jo normal bachcha unke ghar ka hai na, wo phas jata hai us poverty trap ke andar. So one has to think of that in that manner also. So our patient population comes with very different comorbidities. This is an unrepaired patient who has brain abscess, who has severely thick blood. So his blood ki vessels ko strokes hue hain, uska bleeding. Hamara jo TOF yahan pe aake operate karte hain, tetralogy of flow, unki itni bleeding hoti hai post-operatively ki usko aapko handle karna bada mushkil ho jata hai. Sahi hai? So if you don't understand all of those things and you are treating them as somebody that you saw in the US, you may not do the right job. And so is so in the inequities and the disparities at some levels are also your challenges, but also at some level helps you innovate. Because jab hum innovate karte hain, it matters to 90% of the world. And also some of the work that we have been doing in diagnostics using artificial intelligence and everything is going to be something that will actually help even the West in delivering high quality care in a resource limited environment. Because what COVID taught us resources are not unlimited. They can actually become limited, and very quickly they will also go into a mindset jo main aapko dikhaunga jahan pe wo bhi decide kar rahe honge ki kaun sa patient ventilator pe jaye aur kaun sa nahi jaye. Acha to ye ek similar kind of thing. So late presentation, comorbidities, they will have malnutrition, they have infection, so they come with all of these comorbidities. This is just data from a collaborative that collects data from developing countries, and it basically showed ki hamare ha post operative infection is a major driver of mortality. So agar hame data pata hoga, hame apne हमारे जो केयर डिलीवरी पैथवेज में हमें अपनी इनएक्विटीज और डिस्पैरिटीज का पता होगा, चाहे वो फिजिकल डिस्पैरिटीज हैं, चाहे वो क्या नाम है फिजियोलॉजिकल डिस्पैरिटीज हैं, देयर आर मल्टीपल वेज इन विच यू कैन डिवाइड दैट. वन कैन देन स्टार्ट टारगेटिंग सम ऑफ दीज एंड देन हेल्पिंग इंप्रूविंग आवर आउटकम्स. So, you know, you put all of that, a late presenter with comorbidities, and now you put them into a setup. Ye US ka setup hai. They can look at their ICU, look at their teams. So, ye hamari Kabul ki bichari ek nurse thi, jisko mushkil se sikhate hain, aur phir wo jab seekh jati to wo Kuwait bhag jati hai. Sahi hai? So, you know, we lose them to Kuwait. And then you have, you know, this is a very good ICU, by the way. Man, otherwise, so kai aise ICUs hote jahan pe ek hi bistar pe do bacche pade hue hote hain. Sahi hai? So you bring them now, all of that complicated late presenter into a similar kind of a setting. And this was a very interesting statement that I saw, ke brain drain ka sirf effect ye nahi hota ke you are losing sharp brains, you're actually left with some of the weaker ones at times. But that is also a challenge, because sometimes wo agar hum human inequity ko dekhein ki maybe that's where you have to put the maximum amount of support. And one has to assume ki yaar dekho human potential hai, us human potential ko hamein nurture karna hai aur unko lift karna hai hamein. Sahi hai? And that and some of that we have done in Iraq and in Kabul, jahan pe literally at times we were so frustrated ki ek presentation ho rahi hai aur usme itna shor macha hua hai aur main aur Munir wahan baithe sar pakde mein ki yaar how do we get over this? And then we had to move on. Have a lot of kawa, kawa, dhamak ko apna set kiya. And then, kyunki you just can't push people. You may have the Ferrari engine, but there are people with the Chinchi engine or the Raksha engine along with you, and you just can't push them with that. You have to take them along. And what you see is that you go a far longer distance if you kind of have that kind of support. So global disparity, again, majority of the disease lies there. Sabse least amount of cardiac care wahan pe hai. Or in fact, if you start going into infant surgery, neonatal surgery, even less support hai in developing part of the world. So 7%. This is just, a kind of a comparison, US or Pakistan ka, 150 pediatric cardiac centers, Pakistan mein 10 hai, 296 active physicians in pediatric cardiology, humare paas 50 hai. वहां पे सर्जन भी बहुत ज्यादा है, हमारे पास 16 है. तो ना सिर्फ हमारी डिजीज बर्डन ज्यादा है, हमारा कॉम्प्लेक्स केयर है, हमारा ये भी एक बहुत मेजर फैक्टर आ जाता है कि जिसमें एंड देन कॉस्ट ऑफ केयर. एक एवरेज अगर आप कार्डियक सर्जरी और जैसे जैसे डॉलर बढ़ता है और ज्यादा खास इंटरवेंशन लैब में इफ यू पुट डिवाइसेज इन एंड वी आर इंपोर्टिंग दैट डिवाइसेज कॉस्ट. सो हाउ डू यू डील विद इवन द कॉस्ट ऑफ केयर? सो कॉम्प्लिकेटेड डिजीज, लेट प्रेजेंटर, दे गोना स्टे इन योर आईसीयू लॉन्गर एंड देन इट्स गोना कॉस्ट यू. So that all complexity, one can see it, look at it as something that is challenging and get kind of depressed about it, or one can innovate. And that innovation that I call the frugal implementation of frugal implementation innovation can actually be replicated at 90% of the population. And if one goes with that mentality, aapki research will matter. It will actually get published in very high places if you are writing from that lens and that angle, because people want to look at solutions. Just to give you an idea, this is a paper from one of my mentors, Krishna Kumar, who's done some remarkable work in Kerala. And a lot of what he has learned is what we are emulating in how we're going to deliver care, inshallah, at SIUT. Because he has learned high volume care in a low resource setting, dealing with a similar kind of patient population that we deal with. And he has systematically developed himself in creating a program. And what he looked at, ki the majority of dekhen ki jab aap kisi ko complex care kar dete hain without giving them the support, the financial support. So finances, we have put it in as one of the metrics, as one of our morbidity metric. Ki agar aapki fine, kyunki somebody has to pay, even if there is a no cash counter, somebody has to pay. And if you don't look at finances as a morbidity of what you do, you are not gonna change or bring quality improvement in improving finances, because it can put people in debt, it can put systems in debt. So this is the kind of the balance. Available resources bahut kam hai, burden of disease bahut zyada hai, this kind of a summary. And kabhi kabar jab main apne western doston se baat kar raha hota hu, khas taur pe jo yahan se hamare gaye hue hain kafi sare, wo us lens ko samajh nahi pate. कहते यार तुमने ये क्यों किया, ये इस तरह से क्यों किया, तुमने नॉर्थवुड छोड़ दिया, तुमने हाइपोप्लास को तुमने कुछ नहीं करते. एंड आई सेड कि यार देखो, एंड देन कोरोना हैपेंड एंड देन इट गेव मी एन अपॉर्चुनिटी टू से देखो, जब तुम रिसोर्स कंस्ट्रेंट होते ना, तुम लोग भी डिसाइड करते हो कि किसको डालना है किसको नहीं डालना है. सो डोंट जज मी इफ आई एम नॉट ट्रीटिंग अ हाइपोप्लास्टिक लेफ्ट हार्ट सिंड्रोम विच हैज अ वेरी डिसिमल लॉन्ग टर्म आउटकम इवन इन योर सेटअप, राइट? एंड इन डूइंग सो आई कैन ड्रेन अ सिस्टम, ड्रेन अ फैमिली, and put them on a path that is completely not required for what I'm doing. In the end, am I treating my ego? Or am I treating ki main tumhare forum pe baith ke bol sakun ki maine 20 Norwoods kiye hain? Who cares? But for me, what is important, for us, what is important is ki hamara aisa bachcha koi bhi community mein na rahe ki jisko ek time repair ho jaye aur uski zindagi hum jaison ki tarah guzre. और अगर हम उसको छोड़ दें तो वो एक ऐसा उस ऐसे पाथ पे चला जाए कि जहां पे कि हमारी जैसी जिंदगी ना गुजार सके. व्हाई नॉट वी गो फॉर दैट? व्हाई इज इन दैट अ डेफिनेशन ऑफ माय सक्सेस? व्हाई शुड माय डेफिनेशन बी डिफाइंड बाय हाउ यू आर लुकिंग एट सक्सेस? एंड कोरोना गेव मी दैट अपॉर्चुनिटी ऑफ सेइंग कि भाई तुम लोग भी रिसोर्स कंस्ट्रेंट हो तो तुम लोग भी चूज करते हो. सो व्हाई कंजेनिटल हार्ट डिजीज? आप फिर हम मुझसे कहेंगे यार इतना मसले हैं मुश्किल डिजीज है, महंगी है, सब कुछ है, व्हाई डू यू वांट, व्हाई डज एसआईयूटी हैव टू गेट इनटू दिस, मतलब व्हाई, क्यों पंडोरास बॉक्स खोल रहे हैं, क्यों एक हम उसको कर रहे हैं भाई, सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंटल गोल को देखें जिसके सिग्नेटरी हम भी हैं, कि जी हमने न्यूनेटल मोर्टेलिटी कम करनी है, हमने ये करना है, देखिए रिसीव 1/3 प्रीमैच्योर मोर्टेलिटी ऑफ नॉन कम्युनिकेबल डिजीज, द मेजर टू किलर्स इन पाकिस्तान इज स्ट्रोक एंड कार्डियक डिजीजेस, अडल्ट की बात कर रहा हूँ, सही है, कार्डियक डिजीज का अडल्ट का देयर इज अ ह्यूज बार्कर्स हाइपोथेसिस की ओरिजिन इन यूट्रो होती है, सो द इन यूट्रो एक्सपोजर ऑफ अ चाइल्ड पुट्स देम ऑन अ पाथ ऑफ हैविंग अ पुअर कार्डियक आउटकम एज एन अडल्ट, हैव वी थॉट अबाउट इट, सही है, पर हम डायरिया निमोनिया की मेंटालिटी से निकलेंगे तो हम इन चीजों को देखेंगे ना, तो व्हाई शुड आवर हेल्थ केयर बी डिफाइंड बाय द एक्सटर्नल फंडर्स, व्हाई शुडंट वी डिफाइन आवर हेल्थ केयर आउटकम्स एंड स्टफ, एंड कंजेनिटल हार्ट डिजीज एज आई सेड कि जैसे जैसे जो जो आपकी कम्युनिकेबल मोर्टेलिटी है वो कम होती जाती है, कंजेनिटल हार्ट डिजीज आपकी इमर्ज करेगी, क्योंकि वो तो कॉन्स्टेंटली जितने बच्चे पैदा हो रहे होंगे उसका 1% होना है कंजेनिटल हार्ट डिजीज, वो आता रहेगा, बट इफ यू वर टू वेक अप नाउ कि यार सही है अब करेंगे, इट टेक्स 10 इयर्स टू डेवलप अ सेंटर ऑफ एक्सलेंस, एंड दिस इज डेटा फ्रॉम केके हु हैड 10 इयर्स ऑफ डेडिकेटेड वर्क टू डेवलप अ सेंटर ऑफ एक्सलेंस, जहां पे कि आप लेस देन 5% मोर्टेलिटी पे आ रहे हो अपने और आपकी सिस्टम कॉस्ट कम हो रही होगी, कृष्णा कुमार इज वन ऑफ माय मेंटर, इम्पॉर्टेंट टू अंडरस्टैंड इज के वी कांट वेक अप कि यार जब ये कर्व करीब आने शुरू होंगे उस वक्त जागेंगे, क्योंकि 10 साल लगेंगे हमें एक, दिस इज नॉट ORS को पानी में मिलाया पिला दिया किसी को, सही, दिस इज कॉम्प्लेक्स डिजीज विद अ लॉट ऑफ कॉम्प्लेक्स सिस्टम्स, एंड दिस इज अ स्लाइड दैट आई वांट टू काइंड ऑफ टेल यू, सो बर्डन ऑफ डिजीज दैट कुड बी अवर्टेड बाय स्केलिंग अप सिलेक्टेड सब स्पेशलिटी सर्जिकल केयर इन लो मिडिल इनकम कंट्री, द मैक्सिमम इंपैक्ट इज इफ यू स्केल अप कंजेनिटल हार्ट डिजीज एंड the resources there, ताकि एक गोरे का लिखा हुआ पेपर है ताकि मैं मान जाए हम सब, you know, so वो हमारी भी एक mentality है ना, so ये this is an adequate congenital heart disease program, there are all these different moving parts, और हम जो जिस तरह से इंशाल्लाह फेस करेंगे अपने आप को, इन phases को लेके चलेंगे और इन तमाम चीजों को contextualize करते हुए, and the eventual goal is कि जी we will come to, you know, the bigger picture is to developing a quality institution, a center of excellence. And that, and those are all the other moving parts along with it. This make it not sirf jo hai aap care delivery aur apne outcomes ko behtar kar rahe hain, but aap policy make kar rahe hain, aap policies ko change kar rahe hain, aap community ke andar jaake in cheezon ko deal kar rahe hain. So, you know, these are the challenge buckets that I kind of, we have broken it down, ki bhai hamare kya challenge buckets hain aur un challenge buckets ko hum kis tarah se systematically deal kar sakte hain. I'm not going to go into a lot of details of this, but you know, and then we've kind of broken it down into what are the factors that are that we can easily influence and what are the factors that we cannot easily influence, you know, like for example undernutrition is a big undertaking and shayad hum us waqt tak na pahunch sake, but you know there are many possible things that are under our control, quality of surgical repair, you know, post operative infection control, having a infection control team, having a quality of surgical repair kaise behtar hogi agar diagnostics achhi hogi, sahi hai, so And having that all those team members kind of come into play gives us a possible way of things that are under our control. Again, in that example, sorry. Yahan pe sorry, slow lag kar raha hai. Okay, so again, surgical outcomes ke bahut tarike, and the reason I'm showing some of these slides is ke isko systematically is tarah se humne socha hai aur humne where we are currently located, we have done it systematically in that manner, that we have broken our problems down in these systematic ways and then kind of introduce different factors wahan pe ki jis tarah se hum cheezon ko control kar sakte hain, and this is our chance to now scale that care model that we have developed in a smaller setup. So you know, ek is slide dalne ka main sirf ye maqsad kehna chah raha tha ki sometimes systematic system based approach is what is required. So even infection control, you know, is not a one man job or one woman job or, you know, one person's job, you know, it requires a whole team. So ye jo jack of all trades wala jo hamari mentality hai, hame isko change karna hai. Healthcare is a very complex thing. Hum apni echo lab mein hamare sonographers hamare echo karte hain aur mujhse hamesha aake mere patients kehte hain, par doctor sahab wo to doctor khud karte hain echo, aur main kehta hu mera kaam nahi hai echo karna, वो करेंगी एको, वो दिन के 30 एको करती हैं, वो मुझसे 1000 गुना बेहतर करती हैं, हाँ पढ़ना मेरा काम है, पढ़ना उनका काम नहीं है, एंड systematically by doing that, how we have improved our diagnostic quality. And Dr. Shazi has published a paper on this. Okay, you know, we have systematically improved our diagnostic quality. That doesn't give any surprise in the OR. That doesn't give any surprise post-operatively. That makes your patient go home early and saves cost. So systematic approach is important, and jack of all trades sometimes does not work. And again, reducing cost can be different to aspects. Humne usko bhi employ kiya. We have published all of this journey, by the way, and that's a separate talk that we can give on how we have systematically reduced costs by doing different targeted measures in our labs. And what is interesting, we just compared the data of the low middle income cath cardiac catheterization patients compared to the high income US based centers. And what is interesting is that hamare same procedure risk scoring mein, we have half the time, the procedure time that we have is half that of what they're using in the US. And procedure time is directly associated with mortality and morbidity. So why was our procedure time limited? Because hum adult lab mein kar raha hota, bahar adult wala khada hota, jaldi khatam karo, mujhe andar aana. But maintaining the same adverse outcomes. So that is innovation. So literally they are like scratching their heads and saying, yaar, there's something to learn from this lab. Ki yaar, ye aadhe time mein ye kaam karte hain, aur inka adverse event wohi hai jo hamare wala. So there's something to learn. And I think that's inshallah something that we have been doing. This is my last slide. And again, basically, the mindset, the willingness to deeply connect and reach out to average family. This is, you know, how do you deliver quality pediatric? And that is what has brought us to this place, is to really deeply connect to those people who really need some of these services that we can offer and some of the learning that we have offered. So that mindset, change of mindset, took us 10 years to have that change of mindset. But sometimes wo 10 saal bhi bahut zaruri hoti hain aapko maturity level pilane ke liye. And then all of these different things, ke bhai aap inexpensive essentials aapne create karne hain, tailoring solutions that are socioeconomic reality. You know, this is another very important thing. Reluctance to accept expensive new technology without proof of measurable incremental benefit, systematically documented. That does not mean ke long feasibility reporting karo and kill every innovation. Don't kill every innovation, but make them think. Make them think as an implementation scientist. कि यार ये जो तुम इनोवेशन लाना चाह रहे हो चाह रही हो टेक्नोलॉजी लाना चाह रहे हो इसका इम्पैक्ट में सोचा है और अगर सोचा है तो उसको कैसे मेजर करोगे उस पाथ को मेक देम थिंक बट डोंट किल दैट आइडिया मेक देम थिंक एटलीस्ट एंड देन इम्प्रोवाइजेशन इनोवेशन एंड देन इंक्लूसिव डेफिनेशन ऑफ प्रोग्रेस यू नो इंक्लूसिव डेफिनेशन ऑफ प्रोग्रेस को ना सिर्फ मैं टीम बेस्ड इंक्लूजन की बात करता हूँ बट ऑल्सो इंक्लूजन ऑफ आर कॉन्टेक्स्ट इंक्लूजन ऑफ आर सोशल डेमोग्राफिक्स Include all of that in defining what progress means. We should not be killing ourselves. Ki yaar, maine Norwood procedure ya ye complex surgery maine nahi ki. Why? I should be proud about the fact, or we should be proud about the fact that not a single VSD, ASD, jo ke single one-time surgical lesions hote hain, ki humne koi bhi nahi choda apne mulk mein. Hum unko detect karte hain, operate karte hain, unko finally jo hai unke destination tak pahuncha dete hain. So, you know, there are different health system challenges को हमने breakdown किया है और इस slide के बाद मैं आपको सिर्फ दिखाऊंगा तो हमने इसको again breakdown करके all of this we have now put it into a phase approach and so ये हमारा phase approach की एक summary है और इस phase approach का पूरा एक document detailed document है जो कि Dr. Shazia Nadeem हम लोगों ने बनाया है जिसमें कि हम किस तरह से phase approach करेंगे into because what we have learned from day one we would not be operating until unless we have a surgical team, infection control, all of this. Again, not looking for perfection, but also not looking to start something which will put you on a path of failure. So all of that learning we bring in, learning from Iraq, learning from Kabul, ki acha wahan jo cheeze hain humne kis tarah se usme cheezon ko maintain karte hue humne kiya hai. To ye sari ki sari phase approach humne design ki hai and us phase approach ke mutabik hum inshallah kaam karenge. And we will never lose sight that the future of child should not be determined by imaginary lines on the globe. So it may be a big, huge dream. But again, you know, future itself also has a flexible definition. And as long as, you know, hum unko as community ko bhi as partners rakhte hue, hum unka jo definition of future hai, uske mutabik hum kaam kare, then definitely those imaginary lines can be taken off the globe. Thank you very much.
Fabulous talks. Both talks were absolutely amazing. And mujhko to bahut pasand aaya. I mean, I had no idea about the extent of the impact of little children with heart disease and how much impact they have on healthcare and the systems and economy of the country, the potential that you can improvement that you can bring up by focusing over there and doing it. So, and you very nicely summed up, both of you, how you have actually brought experience from outside in very difficult circumstances and are trying to build a system based in Pakistan, Karachi, now looking at SIUT to build it so that you can actually realize this model that you're talking about. And this is a unique experience experiment that you're actually doing. This has not been done anywhere else. And you brought your experience from abroad, you brought experience from UK and US, and the experience of working within excellent tertiary care setups in Pakistan and in trying circumstances, and then developing something that is workable, that is contextual for our setup. So it has a great deal of potential, provided you have that space, which you now do, and you already bring that energy. Now I'm opening this for questions. Please reduce yourself before you ask the question, and keep the question brief. For the online participants, please just put your questions in the chat box that Fareed Saab is actually following. I don't have access to that, so Fareed can add to that. So the first question, Dr. Bozza.
Hi, I'm Richard Gross from the United States. Can you hear me over there?
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. Dr. Mazum and I go back a long time, and she is truly remarkable. I was initially interested in watching this because of the Afghanistan collection. I went over to visit Dr. Mazum and went to Peshawar three times in the late 1980s, 90. And I was interested in your description of how difficult it was to work there, and that, you know, you were regarded as a hostile country, and obviously you diverted your resources other directions, which was much more productive. And my question I would like to ask any of you is, what is it like now to try for Afghanistan for kids to get care there?
Robert Gross, Mr. Gross, or it's Dr. Gross. Doctor. Yeah. Doctor. Mr. is in UK. So.
Yes.
I think Afghanistan is still struggling. They have two centers now. One is in Kabul. In fact, both are in Kabul. One is run by the French mission, and one is another private hospital. But the care provided is only minuscule. They do about 400 to 500 cases a year. Majority of the patients from Afghanistan do come to Pakistan in Peshawar and in Quetta, and through Quetta into Karachi. So a lot of work still needs to be done in Afghanistan. It is obviously a little different now than when we went and did our first mission. And I remember that I was operating on a tetralogy of fellow patient, and we were pulled out of the theater with the patient still on the operation table because we had to leave Afghanistan as there was going to be a conflict. And it took us about 7 hours to reach the airport. Mm. But it's hopefully better now. We can reach it in 2 hours probably.
Thank you. I also want to say that.
Can I just say hello? Hi, Dick. Good to see you. I think people will be interested, and if you don't mind, Dr. Gross does fantastic. He's an orthopedic surgeon. And in the 1980s, when AKU had just started, Dr. Gross was doing a lot of work in Peshawar with some of the children there. And the first major orthopedic surgical case that was done in AKU was because Dr. Gross was in Peshawar. And he came down and he took care of this kid that we flew down from Chitral. And it's an interesting story. So thank you very much for I'm seeing you after a very long time. Good to have you here. Thank you.
Thank you. And the other thing that watching this did is illustrates the insanity in some of the things we discuss over here in the United States healthcare compared with the needs of so much of the rest of the world. It's sobering. Thank you so much for this presentation.
Ali Lanewala, pediatric nephrologist. During my pediatric training in pediatric ICU, I had this experience of firsthand seeing these complex cardiac children being operated. And unfortunately, that child passed away. That whole team was devastated, including that critical care, the surgeon. We did not see the surgeon coming back to the hospital for a good 2-3 days. I was wondering, you must have had failures too. What are your coping mechanisms when you're dealing with such high volumes? Because that surgeon could take off 2 days for grief. But how do you, you know, when you're operating on 2-3 cases in a day, and if you suffer a loss, how do you deal with it?
So it's very common for surgeons to break down and be very depressed and unhappy, and they want to, you know, question themselves that why did I bloody hell come into this profession? Yeah. And I was going through that phase, and I spoke to my mentor. And I said, you know, I have a mortality of 10%, 12%. I want it to be about 3%. And he said that, Munir, look at the 90% that have been helped by you. Don't look at the 10%. The 10% will come down. But think of the 90% that your care has improved their life. And that showed me that, you know, we have to look at the positives. We will get depressed and we will cry, but we have to come back and start all over again. And it's a mental strength. And the problem with pediatric cardiac surgery is that you do not treat the patient. You treat the whole family, and you rejoice with the family and you cry with the family. So you live with the family. That's my take from this whole profession that I've been with for the last 20, 25 years.
To add on to this as well, so we as cardiologists also feel the pain because the child was growing with us and then we lose the patient. But then we have to learn from our mistakes. We do like constantly keep on learning from mistakes, or you can say from failures or from mortalities as well. So we have a very robust mortality and morbidity meeting system in which we break down everything and we look at the causes and then we try and learn from them. And then once we are successful, next time the pain kind of goes away, but you're right, it lingers on, and the child is with you every time, but then you have to come you have to be professional and strong and then less emotional at times.
So Ali, and Ekorchi is very important, and one of the important thing is that showed the willingness. So the willingness is not from just the individual level, but the willingness is also for the institution that is venturing on this path. The willingness to accept ke failures hoenge. The easiest thing for us to do is to refuse the surgery. Ke nahi yaar, kuch nahi kar sakte. And us blue baby ko wapas bhijwa do. But is it pushing the field? If Robert Gross had done that when he was ligating the PDA, would we have ever had the Munir Amanullah now? You know, so I think one has to, as long as we have a robust system of going back, learning, documenting, tracking, benchmarking what we are doing. And that's what we have learned over the past, okay, bhai, quality improvement. In fact, from centers that have done high volume, like KK Kumar in Kerala, Krishna Kumar, his center does around 1500 surgeries a year, congenital heart disease surgery. That is more than what Boston Children does, with less than 5% mortality and highly complex cases. You know, so he's one of the major referral centers for now many of the other region sending them. And how did he get there? He got there by systematically documenting, working on the failures, and working as a team, and then having an inclusive definition of progress. You have to have an inclusive definition of progress. please, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm Farhan Bukhari. I'm probably the only non-medical person in this room. I'm a journalist by profession. I write about healthcare, or among the few. I had the pleasure of meeting with Dr. Munir and Dr. Babar Hassan and the team in Najaf. There are many stories from Iraqis that I could share with you, but that would take up a lot of time. I wrote about their work, and interestingly, from the emails that came across from several readers, the most frequently asked question was the following. What would it take for these miracle solutions? SIUT is a miracle. Dr. Adib Rizvi is a miracle. This team is a miracle. There are others that we can count. But what would it take to turn these miracles into a kind of a national wave across Pakistan? Turn this into a broader kind of feeling across Pakistan. Whenever I'm based in Islamabad and here for this event, but outside Karachi, as you move up north, I think the number of similar miracle initiatives begin to shrink very visibly. Philanthropy becomes more informal, whereas in Karachi, I think there's a larger segment. This is more anecdotal than statistical, although there's some statistical evidence to back up this view. What would it take to kind of really turn this into a national wave at a time when we visibly face healthcare crisis across Pakistan, which has multiple dimensions? That's another story that we can get into. Thank you.
So I would ask Dr. Babar to answer this, but one simple answer is hard work, honesty, and taking the dream forward. Dr. Adib was the person who started all this SIUT with 8 beds, and he has brought this forward. This gave us courage, and this gave us the dream, the strength to dream. And now we are here, as Dr. Munir said, that despair, delusion, and delivery. So we are now planning to deliver. So I think the work will speak. The way we will work and the teams will work, the word spreads. You are the one who spread the word by as a journalist. And then the other people, the juniors and the young doctors, will take the example and will join the team. And this is how the wave will become. Samandar darya darya karke jo hai, katra katra darya banta hai, to phir wo leher uthegi. Jab sab dekhenge, wo leher mein shamil honge, aur phir leher zor pakdegi.
May I make a comment? आपने जो ये सवाल किया ना, इट्स एन एक्सट्रीमली इम्पोर्टेंट सवाल है. सो द वे आई लुक एट इट, इन माय ओपिनियन, द फर्स्ट थिंग इज कि मिरेकल्स हटा दें. सो द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ मिरेकल्स इज समथिंग दैट आई थिंक शुड नॉट बी पार्ट ऑफ इट. The main thing, and that goes back a little bit to Dr. Shazia, is it's a gradual process. And it's a process that I do see a potential for in Pakistan. Ki jo ye centers hain, jo yahan baat ho rahi hai, whether it's clinics, clinical work mein, ya for that matter, ye aap jahan baithe hue hain, this is the only center of biomedical ethics in Pakistan. It works by seeding the rest of the country. And that's what is where it won't be a miracle. But if you train enough people, I mean, I think the potential in Pakistan is incredible. So one thing is, okay, I don't believe in miracles. I believe in, as you say, hard work. But the hard work means training other people. And it is they who you are up, ye beej bote hain. So but whatever happens may not happen in our lifetime. But it will happen. And the last thing is mein jo hai, jo hamari Pakistanis are constant pessimism. I mean, it is good to be objective and say ki ye sahi nahi hai, ye sahi nahi hai. Lekin ek, and I have been back in Pakistan now long enough, ki ek ye jo negative cheez jo hai, ye nahi ho sakti hai. Government kharab hai, wo kharab hai, etc. I think ye, again, core group jo hai, if you get the people who think like you on board, and they are there, I think ye badlega. Hamari lifetime mein nahi bhi badle, lekin if we do that, that's the way to go. We need systems. We need individuals like Adib Saab, but we need systems. he Adeep Saab is the icon, but we need systems. And this, I think, what we have heard from both of them today, that's how I took it. And the systems is, it's a slow process. And the thing is, don't be cynical. Because if you are cynical about what can be done over here, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. Kuch nahi hoga.
It's not only slow, it's iterative. One has to understand ki iterative process hai. और इटरेटिव प्रोसेस उसी वक्त आप कर सकते हैं जब आप कलेक्ट अपने डेटा कलेक्ट कर रहे हैं. यू कांट जस्ट हैव इटरेशन आउट ऑफ एनेक्डोटल स्टफ. यू हैव टू हैव इट विद ऑब्जेक्टिविटी. एंड एक आखिरी कमेंट करके मैं लेट मुनीर टॉक अबाउट, बट जो आपने एक और बात की, देखें वी हैव टू आल्सो हैव ओनरशिप. सही है. सो हम अपने नेबरिंग कंट्री से, मैं एक टॉक देता हूँ जब मैं जाता हूँ, एंड आई सम पीपल विल आस्क मी दिस क्वेश्चन, आई विल शो देम दिस वीडियो ऑफ मोहम्मद आमिर टेकिंग द विकेट ऑफ विराट कोहली in the ICC Champions Trophy. And usme sab itne khush hue hain ki dekho humne pakistan ko matlab pakistan jeet gaya. Sahi hai, whatever all of this. And what I show ki yaar kaash ke ye khushi hame congenital heart disease ya is tarah ki specialties mein bhi ho ki yaar hum, you know, 30% of Pakistani kids go and get operated in our neighboring country. And it is hats off to them, because that's how they have developed their system, because they have taken ownership of what their, it is not a isko kehte hain for lack of, not to make it sound political, but it's not an important agenda ke ji ye hamara healthcare agenda ye ke humne ye karna hai bhai hamara to jo hamara mara wo coronary artery disease ye hai aur congenital heart disease aapka char countries hai mainly matlab why haven't you invested in that so that kind of a mentality and stuff.
Yeah, mainly I think we have to blame ourselves to an extent also. The team, that we have not actually propagated ourselves at all. We have not publicized ourselves. Now, no other team has ever gone outside of Pakistan and operated. And that too on hearts. The biggest centers are in Islamabad and Lahore, but they have never gone outside and developed another unit. They've only concentrated on themselves. And the other thing that we need to realize is that we can learn from anyone, and we should be able to learn from everyone. And I mean, my secret to some of the success that I have has been learned from Dr. Abdal. He was one of the most calmest senior residents I could come across. And the patient is dying and he will still be calm. And I will be, something is happening. What we should do? So you have to learn from everyone, and you will learn different aspects from people. But the ability and the willingness to learn should be there. And only then we will be able to progress.
Can I make a comment on this, please?
Just a quick comment. It is very, very important to set examples by doing. Hum Pakistani qaum ka issue ye hai ki hum bolte to bahut hain aur karte nahi hain. So, set example by doing.
I would like to make a comment on this. My name is... isi ke upar comment, actually.
Okay, so...
I think the gentleman's question... My name is Shai Shamim. I'm a professor of surgery and... medical educationist. The gentleman's question was that how is it, or whether it can become a national wave. I kind of not agree with what I've heard, because whatever you are saying, whatever we are talking about here is not going to become a national wave unless and until the policies that Professor Adeep Rizvi has enforced or implemented in SIUT becomes national policies. Yes, Dr. Amanullah, Dr. Babar, and your team, they can ek center se shayad do center se shayad teen center ho jaye agle 100 saal mein. The 15 years have passed, we are still with one center of bioethics in Pakistan. So not in 100 years, please do not expect that will become a national wave unless and until national policies become what Dr. Adeep Rizvi has done in SIUT.
Though Shahid, that I would disagree with you on that, because jo Center of Biomedical Ethics jo hai ek center hai, but we have data on those who have graduated from here. where they are now in their own institutions, where they have introduced bioethics, where people didn't even know what it meant. So therefore, I think jo yahan SIUT mein jo hota hai, a lot of it, as I said, Adeep Saab is an icon. Without him, SIUT, to forget it, what he struggled to get it through. Now through SIUT, SIUT is now involved beyond SIUT. And it is opening centers, and it is a slow process, but it is spreading. But as I said, ye ek lifetime ki baat nahi hoti. And if we think that way, na, we get very discouraged. It's a longer process.
Okay, so we have an online question from Dr. Shanza. And she asked, does resources limitation in management influence the decision-making process in compromising on the best management available? And are there any palliative treatments care available while awaiting for surgery?
So, बहुत अच्छा सवाल है. तो देखें, again, मेरा वही है कि there are quite a bit of innovation that has come out from low middle income countries and stuff. And वो innovation ये दिखाता है कि कभी कभार जो है आपको जो defined care के standards हैं कि यार ये defined standards से मुराद ये कि surgical standard की बात कर रहा हूँ, you know, कि giving you example, हम एक हमारा एक प्रोसीजर होता है उसको PDA डिवाइस कहते हैं. वो डिवाइस क्लोजर जो है वो हम US का एक खास डिवाइस होता है, UK का वो यूज करते हैं. एंड वन ऑफ द पर्सन फ्रॉम लो मिडिल इनकम कंट्री सेड व्हाई आर यू यूजिंग अ डिवाइस, यू कैन यूज अ मल्टी कॉइल टेक्निक एंड क्लोज इट. सो लैक ऑफ इनोवेशन गिव्स यू एन अपॉर्चुनिटी टू लैक ऑफ रिसोर्सेज गिव्स यू एन अपॉर्चुनिटी टू इनोवेट. सो देयर आर मेनी इनोवेशन दैट कम आउट ऑफ इट. हाँ, पैलिएटिव बिल्कुल हैं. पैलिएटिव ये होता है कि as I said, you have to put the risk and benefit of the patient, ke bhai agar aap usko chhod denge with a saturation of 40%, there is nothing, you have to do something. It's a surgical disease, you have to do something, some kind of a surgical bridging therapy. Munir ne abhi pichle jo Iraq mein jo mission humne kiya, literally ye ek operation theater mein khada ho, dusra patient jo hai wo unhone pump pe usko cardiac bypass pe abhi liya nahi hai, usko induction diye, anesthesia ki, and his saturation was 20. And they rapidly went in, and he could have decided, "Kyaar, I'm going to do a simple surgery, your BT shunt kehlata hai, palliation, or I'll just do a full repair and give the child the best chance." So palliation at times has to be thought about as a kind of a journey mein ek step, but don't just say, "Kyaar, yahi pe ruk jayenge." And you have to have a clear justification. Cardiac surgery, agar zara ya cardiology, cardiac surgery. जरा से भी कॉम्प्लिकेटेड होती तो शायद मैं कर भी ना पाता. सही है. तो इट इज वेरी सिंपल, इट्स वेरी एल्गोरिथमिक, एंड यू हैव टू गो थ्रू दैट एल्गोरिथम, एंड यू हैव टू डिसाइड कि यार दिस इज समथिंग दैट हैज टू बी सर्जिकली डेल्ट विद, एंड देन यू कांट जस्ट प्ले अराउंड विद मेडिकेशन, यू हैव टू गो सर्जरी, एंड यू हैव टू जस्ट कॉल द सर्जन एंड डू इट. सही है. तो वो
एंड वन मिसकंसेप्शन दैट पैलिएटिव ऑपरेशन इज इजी एंड हैज गॉट बेटर रिजल्ट्स इज टोटली बुलशिट, सॉरी फॉर द फ्रेंच, बट it has got a higher mortality than doing a complete repair. And mm-hmm. this is world over.
Yes. So thank you. Yeah, okay. Bushra Shirazi, a clinician, general surgeon, and faculty over here too. So it's very heartening and rejuvenating to hear the energy and everything coming out. And I'm going to shift gears, moving from the technical aspect, because we have a tendency, we say, you know, hamare yahan ye system mein aise hota hai. Now you dealing with policies, infrastructure is one set of issues, but dealing with the families is another set of issues. Now starting from a simple thing, when you're taking consent from them and you're trying to make them understand, I would presume, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, whether they actually understand what's going to happen. And is the patient just yours? Because this is a vulnerable person who has no resource, nothing. And he comes to you with inverted commas hope. So how do you deal with that? I mean, this is an ethics center. We talk about informed consent, and we talk about exploitation, and we talk about vulnerability. So these are things that I don't think you can take them out of the equation. How do you deal with that? And this is for anyone.
Shall I take this? So I do a lot of fetal echo. So I do a lot of counseling for with the fetal moms, like the moms who have fetuses with congenital heart disease. And sometimes they have hearts which are not formed. There is a single ventricle. So there are a lot of time we have to, and they come from a very low socioeconomic background, very low educational status. They are very illiterate and they do not understand. They just, you tell them the whole story and their question is, bachcha to theek ho jayega, normal ho jayega, iski shaadi ho jayegi, iske bachche ho jayenge. This is what, ya agar ladka niklega to kama lega. This is what their questions are. So ethics, yes. Consent, yes. You have to tell them the whole story, but you cannot keep, you cannot, aap unko, unke upar decision ka bojh nahi dal sakte. एक ले मैन है और आपको पता है कि अगर एक सिंगल वेंट्रिकल है उसकी आप पेलिएशन करेंगे वो किस उनकी जिंदगी किस तरह गुजरेगी उनके बाकी बच्चे किस तरह सफर करेंगे उनका कमाने वाले का क्या होगा उनको कितने हॉस्पिटल के चक्कर लगाने पड़ेंगे तो समटाइम्स यू हैव टू टेक द डिसीजन फॉर देम लाइक आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट टर्मिनेशन ऑफ प्रेगनेंसी एज वेल यू हैव टू काउंसिल देम बट समटाइम्स काउंसिल देम विद अ लिटिल असर्टिवनेस It depends. Yes. It depends on the person who is sitting in front of you. Like if this is a person who's coming from a very like uneducated background, जिसको बिल्कुल understanding नहीं है और आपको भी पता है कि अगर आप उसको single ventricle या किसी ऐसे complex pathway की तरफ डाल देंगे तो उसकी जिंदगी किस तरह से गुजरेगी और उसको वो किस तरह से अपने resources जमा करेगा So if I have to answer your question ki mostly hota hai ya kabhi kabhi hota hai to I would say ki most of the time when you are dealing with these
Okay
patients.
Can
I just disagree with Shazia
because that's what I was going to do you go ahead
I completely disagree with Shazia yes. I think each yes. one of the people that I have counseled have got the intelligence to make yes. the correct decision And very few of them actually ask me, Doctor Saab, aap kya karenge? And I tell them, I cannot answer that because it is not affecting me. The beauty of counseling depends upon how much you want to counsel. I had the opportunity of working in an ICVD. I used to start my clinic at 9 o'clock and I finish at about 2 o'clock. And I would counsel each parent with diagrams, with outcomes. And not a single parent asked me, "Kitne sir, jaldi karein, humko jana hai." And if you know how an ICVD works, it is a little bit different than what I was practicing. And that was what I was practicing was the AKU in me. It was bound on us that we have to give the information and give the information with integrity. So I feel that once you have given the information, 99% of the parents will make a very conscious decision.
So may I add to that? We should have actually a CBEC forum on this because one of the things is, I think we as physicians, and I speak as one, there's a sense of arrogance in us. We know the clinical part of it, and we may know, you know, how many bachche kitne hain, etc. But in the final analysis, we do not know their situation. And therefore, the word counseling, I always worry about the word counseling because it is not, counseling doesn't mean convincing them. Counseling is laying everything out there. And then also understanding, you know only a little bit of their life. You do not know the rest of their life. And therefore the whole point is to lay it out and help them make the decision. I think this is crucial.
What I meant, to help them making the decision, but help them like with the knowledge that we have as physicians. And we know that what's in front of them.
So,
but that's great. This is only that you're only looking at the medical biological point of view. You have some insight into the rest of it, but family, you can even your own families, how much do you know what's going on in your sister's or brother's family? So that's something in the counseling that we need to keep
So do cheeze yeah. Like Atul Gawande in apni book complication mein exactly is cheez ko he had mentioned this and he talks about the word facilitation.
Yes.
He talks about facilitation because of the fact that he actually partly agrees with what Shrazi is saying in his book complication. Because the interesting data I think has to really understand and one has to so this definition of how much one can counsel or inform consent has to be also contextually defined. One has to, we can't import a definition. And that was something that I learned kyunki main 10 saal ki ek cheez karke jab yahan pe aake maine wo karna shuru kiya to bahut different aapko wo hota hai. And sometimes one has to use some tough words to even make people understand. One has to understand ki agar koi pay nahi kar raha koi to pay kar raha hai. There is a difference between a customer and a consumer. So aapka kabhi ka
consumer and a patient and a doctor.
Haan, par wo, yahan pe bhi main thodi si disagreement karta hun ki main, I use the term customers and consumers in healthcare because we have brought a very negative connotation to these terms from the business world. Whilst we have not taken the very positive connotation of this term from the business world, ke apne customer ko agar aap satisfy karne ki koshish karoge, to aap high quality care deliver karoge. Sahi hai? Aur aapka consumer ya customer bade. Consumer, customer different hamare setting mein hote hain. Hamare paas 80% of our patients are consumer. But they're not customers. The customer is different. The wonder of all of those things and the counseling for a single ventricle. I have realized ki yaar main in families ke saath kar kya raha tha. Inko main kya kis pathway pe dal raha tha. Unke jo baki ghar ke bachche hain unko maine kya aur agar maine wo iterative learning apne counseling mein built nahi ki to maine fir apni art of medicine ko modify nahi kiya. Then I was just using what is published and what is written into a context that is completely different. And I have to accept it. It's okay.
So we need another, here's another thing, because the issue of assertive empathy to me is an oxymoron. It's like military intelligence or jumbo shrimp. It's an oxymoron, but for that we will need yet another. but these are the things that we discussed.
Yeah, kind of running pay on time, but we have to discover part of the online also. So maybe we can try and take the online ones first and then.
Mr. Zulfiqar Ali has asked a question that. How Iran, I think he wants to say Iraq has achieved cardiac centers nationally. What are the policies in long term, if you both could highlight?
He says Iran.
But they were talking about Iraq.
But maybe, do you know anything about Iran?
I've got a very well developed
system. I think that's what he's talking about.
He said,
yeah, okay. So that's okay. So maybe we can move
to the next one. So the next one is from Kalbi Abbas, and he's asking what strategies can be put in place to overcome brain drain, one of the major reasons for lack of complex cardiac care in Pakistan.
Big question. Who would like to feel that?
I don't have an answer for it, but I just know there are three things which make a person do things beyond what they are capable of. One is passion, the other is enumeration, and third is position. You offer the two, enumeration and position, and the passion will increase 100-fold.
So ye extrinsic motivator ki baat kar rahe hain. So he's talking about the extrinsic motivator. So if you read the book Drive by Daniel Pink, he talks and again ye book ko humne kis tarah se implement kiya. So in our quality improvement arms, one of our quality improvement arm is human engagement. How do you engage human? Because aap jitna bhi set up kar le high quality care data registries, it is going to be delivered by humans. So human engagement is actually one of our arms of quality improvement. And we have actually published our work in NEGM actually around this. Kya humne kis tarah se human engagement ko drive kiya. So one has to take care of the extrinsic drive, because without the extrinsic motivation taken care of, but again, wo chadar jitni bhi lambi galne hai, usko thoda sa limit dena padta hai. You then work on the intrinsic motivation. And this may sound philosophical, but please go and read our paper. We'll send it to Dr. Farooq Mazum also. Puri implementation dikhai di humne kis tarah se kiya hua hai with metrics. So the three drivers are autonomy. Give them autonomy. The intrinsic motivator ke liye. And I'll tell you.
The word autonomy.
No. Wo kar lenge.
We need a seminar on bilkul.
We'll talk about that. Second is purpose. You have to give a purpose. And the third, jo aapka, so autonomy, purpose, and mastery. So the ability to, so you have to push the sense of achieving mastery. And mastery is an asymptote curve. It never meets the top line. So if you are driven to achieve mastery in what you are doing, and you are given a purpose for why you are doing it, and you are given the right autonomy, to make it politically proper, because you are absolutely saying that sometimes autonomy, but its also given different definitions in the book. That how you give it, what you do. Yes.
Practically.
Yes. Absolutely. Because heuristic tasks are drive is not so. Aap jo algorithmic task hai, wo different tarike se drive karte hain. Heuristic tasks, different drive. And please, again, this is not theoretical. We have done this work, we have published it, and I can send the paper to you.
And I would agree with Dr. Babar, not that he's my colleague and he's agreeing with me. So, like, we are not. So, I agree, because we did it practically in our Echo Lab. We had like sonographers, we did bring the quality metrics, we brought the quality, but the sonographers were very underpaid.
But we gave them
challenges, we gave them autonomy, we made them technical director, team leaders, and the girls stayed with us and they love to work with us because they have some autonomy. If they tell us, Dr. Shazia, you're not coming in the room for 20 minutes. We need first 20
so
minutes to
some
scan.
Autonomy,
yes, some autonomy. So and that was a controlled autonomy, actually.
So there you go. So autonomy in itself, the interesting thing is, this is a term that is criticized in the United States by social scientists and anthropologists, and by some bioethicists.
Hmm.
Iski understanding to it, it's a philosophical term. Mm. And so anyway, as I said, we would need another session.
So the autonomy did backfire as well. Sometimes it did backfire, and we used to think, oh, zyada autonomy de di hai. But then, you know, right. Like she said, ke aap karte hain aur phir seekhte hain. That's how.
Okay.
Maybe there's some.
Right. I am usually not lost for words here, but today I am with my teachers here. I'm Dr. Khaled Ali Nawaz Mughal, and I am a brand ambassador. Working this one. I'm a brand ambassador for all Pakistan physicians and surgeons for UK. Hafiz sends his salams. And I'm also an AKU alumni. I'm also an SIUT alumni with training. And I'm also a Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh alumni. And today I'm here as Khaled Ali Nawaz. No mysteries here. My question is for everybody, but Prof is here as well. The proof of the pudding is in the eating. We had a great discussion. I want to ask a question. Barbara said systematic approach. What systematic biomedical ethics and cultural approach shall we take to set up a center in Garo, Tata? I've just been to a hospital in Tata, and Maula Bakshi Rozani, the Vadera of the area, is willing to give that hospital. And we're working towards Indus. And he was also willing to give a couple of acres or more for financing of it as well. So what systematic approach shall we have in terms of it? And how do we break the political barrier to set it up? Who will take up the battle?
It was
so you're talking about congenital heart disease or?
Yes. I spoke with Professor Dr. Ahmed Noor, who's my class fellow, and we trained together. And just yesterday I was with him. I'm just passing by. I'm here from Mother's Treatment. I'm just going to go back in a week's time back to UK, where I'm from. And he says, well, he is happy to give his team from Indus, which he was setting up in Gambart previously for, Ahmed is a cardiologist and he's head of Indus over there. He said, I can take my team there, set it up as a primary care, not to do interventions and stuff like that, it's too advanced for that. We set it up for just echoes, just screening echoes. And the whole population of Tata, that's Garo, Garo, Buaro, you know, I'm a bit Sindhi as well. So it's a huge catchment area. And I'm sure there'll be a lot of people with holes in the heart, a lot of kids with holes in the heart. And recently, my own cousin has been operated with a hole in the heart as an adult. So there might be a few around with adults. So pick them up. I don't know how. What is the systematic approach?
Excellent question. So me and Munir and Shazi also now are involved in creating the Global Initiative for Child Surgery for Congenital Heart Disease ka document. Pura. And usme ye systematic level-based approach humne karwai hai. Ke ya level 1 hospital kya hota hai, level 2 kya hota hai, level 3 kya hota hai, 5 tak gaye hai usme. And keep trying to align it with the GICS definition of levels and stuff. So it depends on, but my, even before I start, ke bhai humne wahan pe practically kya karna hai, us institution ka level kya karna hai, mera sawal ek purpose kya hai. वो जो बंदा बना रहा है या जो भी बना रहे
बन चुका है,
नहीं, वो तो even worse, क्योंकि the point, the question is, what was the drive behind them making it? Is the drive के जी मेरे catchment area में एक बच्चा भी heart disease का मुझे नजर नहीं आना चाहिए, बेहतर मतलब सही हो जाना चाहिए, and so I really go into the drive, because what we have, when we have gone into different, and even Iraq पे भी जब हमने गए हैं, और वो जो मुनीर ने बात की थी ना कि, and when we, from the GICS angle, when we go into this one, we try to kind of tease out ki bhai aapko drive kya kar raha hai ye cheez, kyunki ye rasta aasan nahi hai, isme aise aise aapko bumps aate hai na, aur team dynamics aapki disturb hoti hai, cheeze disturb hoti hai, and sabse bada cheez hai ki hospital administration aapse haath uthata hai ki yaar ye kya ho gaya. So until and unless their purpose is very clear, I won't even venture into anything. And if you are as a consultant, giving them consultant, it's not about starting echoes. What's the purpose? Kya karna hai? Echo karke, phir diagnosis karke, clinic community mein phenk dena hai. What is the pathway in which they will be, they will get into care?
We went
that
to...
That pathway is already there. Yeah. So, kidney patients are coming to SIUT, if the liver patients are coming to SIUT, and if SIUT has a pediatric cardiac setup, the obvious thing would be to...
The purpose is to benefit the poor people of the area. Like for example, Adil Heather. Like Adil Heather, he broke the barrier of the disparities with Hispanics, and that's how he landed up becoming the head of academy. Now he's head of AQO Dean. And obviously there has to be an approach. I mean, we can have another seminar on this, but we have something substantive built up hospital. Cheerio. Thank you so much. Thank you. It's good to interact with it's good to interact with my friends. Thank you.
The final,
it's heartening. बहुत मजा आ रहा है आप लोगों की आपस की अंडरस्टैंडिंग केमिस्ट्री देखकर के यू नो द टीम
पूरे कमरे की केमिस्ट्री,
लेकिन इनमें फिजिशियंस भी हैं, सर्जन भी हैं, कार्डियोलॉजी की टीम, हम किडनी वालों में भी यूरोलॉजिस्ट होते हैं, नेफ्रोलॉजिस्ट होते हैं, मकसद ये है कि बीच में कहीं ना कहीं हर आए दिन एक केस ऐसा आ जाता है कि फिजिशियन समझता है कि इसकी सर्जरी होनी चाहिए और सर्जन कहता है कि नहीं नहीं होगी, ये इट्स मोर हार्मफुल देन बेनिफिशियल. आपके दरमियान भी आते तो होंगे ऐसे कॉन्फ्लिक्ट्स, हाउ डू यू सॉल्व इट? इज देयर a hierarchical system, keh diya na maine yun nahi hoga, versus ye ke
if you take congenital cardiac surgery or pediatric cardiac sciences, I personally feel nowhere in the world in any other specialty the team approach is more important. In pediatric cardiology, even if you take US centers, there are always heart centers within a children hospital. No other subspecialty of pediatrics have their own centers within a any children hospital, even in USA. So in congenital cardiac surgery or pediatric cardiac sciences, we always have a team approach. For sending any patient to a surgery, we have multidisciplinary conference in which we discuss pros and cons, ki patient ko offer karna bhi chahiye ya nahi, theek hai. अगर करना चाहिए तो उसके लिए क्या सर्जरी ज्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट है?
नहीं, लेकिन अगर कॉन्फ्लिक्ट आ गया, बिल्कुल
आता है, या कॉन्फ्लिक्ट आता है और देन वी टेक वी डू वोटिंग, ठीक है, एंड देन कंसेंसस, या एंड देन कम अप विद द
चार फिजिशियन एक तरफ, एक सर्जन एक तरफ, लेकिन सर्जन का वोट तो पांच के बराबर है ना.
आई थिंक वी रियलाइज दैट ऑल ऑफ अस विल हैव डिफरेंट एक्सपर्टीज, लेवल ऑफ एक्सपर्टीज, एंड एज अ टीम वी रियलाइज कि हमारी कैपेसिटी क्या है. सो इफ वी गेट एक्साइटेड अबाउट जस्ट एन एग्जांपल, हाइपरप्लास्टिक लेफ्ट आर्म syndrome, which is a very complex operation to do. It can be done. We have done it, but not here in the UK and some surgeons in the US. But should we be doing it? So that is the question. The other is, sometimes the surgeon sees the picture differently than a cardiologist. And he may be able to say that, I think we will run into a problem because this is coming in my way. And I cannot do a complete repair. It will be safer to do a palliative operation. And you would, sometimes the surgeon say, no, I don't think so, this will work. And then the cardiologist will be able to give you the confidence that now it will work. These things are in place. So it is without doubt the most dependent specialty in the world, where a decision is not one person, but a whole team.
और एक और चीज अली, एक और इम्पोर्टेंट ये है कि दैट्स व्हाई कॉन्टेक्स्चुअल डेटा इज इम्पोर्टेंट, क्योंकि जब हम इस तरह के कॉन्फ्लिक्ट में पढ़ते हैं ना, क्योंकि एक्चुअली द अदर वे अराउंड बहुत कम होता है, द अदर वे अराउंड ये होता है, ये तो मैं कर लूंगा, फिर आपको अंदाजा होता है यार 100% मोर्टेलिटी थी, हमने चार किए, चारों के चारों मरे, यू नो. सो दैट ग्राउंड रियलिटी काइंड ऑफ सेटल्स इन, बट इट कांट बी एनेक्डोटल. इफ यू हैव योर ओन डेटा, एंड दैट्स व्हाई इट्स इंपॉर्टेंट, एंड दैट्स व्हाट वी हैव काइंड ऑफ ग्राउंडेड आवरसेल्व्स इनटू, वी कलेक्ट आवर ओन. हमारे सेंटर में हमने क्या किए हैं, कितनों के क्या आउटकम्स रहे हैं, कितना लेंथ ऑफ स्टे था, एंड देन उसके बेसिस पे कन्फ्लिक्ट रेजोल्यूशन होती है ऑन द ऑब्जेक्टिविटी. बट नेचुरल सी बात है, एंड में तो टांका सर्जन ने लगाना है ना. अगर वो कहता है मैंने नहीं करना, दैट डज नॉट मीन कि आपने केयर बच्चे की रोक दी है, क्योंकि यू हैव अदर ऑप्शन, एंड देन यू विल ब्रिंग इट अप इन द मीटिंग. इफ यू आर नॉट विलिंग टू डू इट, कैन आई सेंड इट टू अनदर सर्जन इन द कंट्री, एंड दे विल से या सेंड इट टू द अदर. हम बहुत रूटीनली करते हैं कुछ चीजें, हम एक्यू में अब नहीं कर रहे होते हैं, हम मुनीर को लियाकत भिजवा देते हैं कि मुनीर आपने आप बेहतर कर दो, आप यहाँ कर दो, हमारे सर्जन ने मना कर दिया, एंड ही विल डू इट. इन फैक्ट वी हैव ट्रांसफर्ड केयर पेशेंट्स फ्रॉम आवर आईसीयू इनटू लियाकत आईसीयू बिकॉज आवर सर्जन, एंड राइटली सो, ही सेड आई एम नॉट गोना डू इट, देयर इज अ हाई मोर्टेलिटी, मुनीर एक्सेप्टेड द केस, वी सेंट द केस ओवर टू हिम. बट वो टीम कंसेंसस है, ताकि कोई एक दूसरे को ब्लेम ना करे.
They say ignorance is
my lighter note. One of my mentor used to say there are certain situations in pediatric cardiac sciences jo ke halal to hain lekin makruh hain. So wo hum consensus se define karte hain ki kya halal hai aur kya makruh.
So we have one comment from Dr. Tal and then Dr. Deepeshwi would like to say.
Yeah, I'm very happy to note just a comment that Dr. Mozam's definition of a good physician, which is not just a technician, but also understands the social and ethical aspects. And Dr. Munir, I am very happy to note, is an epitome of what she describes as a good physician. And I think this was the first thing when we joined the residency program, she said, you know, we don't want to make you FRCS, NFCPS, we want to make you good physicians and good doctors. And I said, you know, what crap she's talking about.
Yeah, I used to say, I can teach a monkey
to operate. Yeah. So, well, between me and Dr. Munir, we had a love-hate relationship because I was senior and he was junior. So once, and I was absent-minded and I was disorganized and he was very efficient. So one of the things that really happened, it's not a story, it really happened, was that he was in the OR and I call him up and say, what time is it, Dr. Munir? And he said, it's 11:30. And I said, what have you done? And he said, oh, I've done a cholecystectomy and I'm scrubbing for a hernia. And I said, actually, you know, I forgot we had a tumor board meeting today. And we have a case that you need to prepare. And it's at 12 o'clock. And I've got the slides ready with Murad. He's got all the markers. You just have, and he's got the chart. So you just have to make the slides. And please, on your way to the to Murad, just collect the X-rays from the CT scans from the radiology department. And he's just saying, you know, agar Dr. Abdallah aap subah bhi bata dete to main kar leta. Maine kaha nahi, dekhen aap seedhe niche chale jaye. I'll send somebody else for the hernia. And I'll keep you third on the list. So you have an extra half hour to join up and present your case. So that's this is what I'm saying. We had a love-hate relationship. Yeah. And I'm not really calm. I'm just slow. And that's what I come out as calm.
So I think we had a very, very good session, which can only get better than Dr. Adib Rizvi. There's a few words to close this.
फिर मैं कहूँगा हाथ उठ रहे हैं फातिहा पढ़ें नो आई एम रियली थैंकफुल टू द होल यूनिट स्पेशली टू प्रोफेसर फरहत मौजम ऑफ कोर्स आई एम थैंकफुल टू हर आउट ऑफ फियर एज वेल बिकॉज यू नो यू आर सिटिंग हियर आई कैन टेल एनीथिंग एंड इट हैज बीन एक्सीलेंट द ओनली थिंग इज दैट the new thing which I'm noticing this time in this meeting, people are coming out with the new ideas and discussing the papers very frankly, very openly, and not giving it, unfortunately, to the seniors. I think the next time we should invite the youngsters more, juniors more, and we should put a mask on our face and let the juniors speak about the diagnosis, about everything. Because the same people are sitting here, like me, who long ago had seen any book. So I think we must, you need more space, you need more guests, you need more critics. ने फ्लोर तो बहुत सारे हैं ऊपर ने आप ऑडिटोरियम यूज करें ऑडिटोरियम यूज करें रियली और कीप इट फॉर टू थ्री डेज विद यू बिकॉज इट इज गोइंग टू बी वेरी नाइस और टीचिंग सेशन एंड पीपल विल लुक फॉरवर्ड फॉर दिस थिंग टू हैपन एवरी ईयर. And there you started with hospital, take it to the city level, and then take it to the country level, and then take it to the regional and international. So it can become a permanent feature, and that will be the greatest contribution. So much you have contributed, now it will be additional contribution. Yeah.
अदीब साहब का एक रिमार्क अनवर नकवीर वो ये था कि इन दोनों के लिए ये कह दो कि वेलकम टू द मैड हाउस.
दैट इज देयर.
यस ऑफ कोर्स.
एंड अदीब साहब
आई एम अलाउड one more suggestion, and that is you all the proceedings should be published.
Record to ho hi raha
hai. Yeah.
Should be published.
Okay, well, thank you very much. So I would like to thank Adeep Saab. He was actually in the clinic, and because something ne kaha hua tha ki aapne aana hai, he was kind enough. Come from the clinic. Oh,
who can dare to oppose her?
I should certainly. So he has to head back to the clinic. So I'm really grateful.
It's an honor.
Really, really grateful. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much for the online group that has been throughout. Always less fun to be online because you persevered and thank you for your contributions joined on Zoom and also on Facebook. Thank you very much. And for the physical component, we have a chai outside. For the online components, goodbye.